All right, so here we are back with this Wade and Butcher and my trusty penguins, little mascots. Okay, here's the razor, right? We did a little bit of a restoration on this baby, and I want to get it like shaving. And because I have razors all over the place, I'm not really pressed to do this, so that's why it's still here now, like a good amount of time after I got this all together. And I got the what do you call it, the tension on this pretty nice. It's still gonna flop a little bit, but I can position it and it stays put. And as I'm honing it, it'll loosen up, and then after I finish honing, I'll tap it back down again, and then it should be nice and snug for good long time. These big blades tend to put a lot of strain on the pivot area, so I get used to them loosening up sometimes. Anyway, back to this. I ran into after inspection, ran into some grief. Nah, I don't know if you want to call it grief, just pain in the ass. Right over here. I'm gonna drop some still photos in, but this portion of the heel had been damaged by what we call Swiss cheese, rotten steel, micro pitting, whatever you want to call it, and it was like visibly like dented. The steel had just failed. And what I think maybe might have happened over time, like the blade sitting like this in a drawer and like maybe tipped back and moisture running down and just sort of accumulating there or something. I don't know. It's just a dream. It doesn't matter. Exactly what happened is irrelevant. Well, the course of events are irrelevant. What happened was is, I had a terrible time over here. Now, if you remember, I had what I called out as excessive wear up at the toe. So I had planned on honing into this profile a little bit more of a curve than was there originally. Kind of like sort of take away from the visual up here was a little, it was a blunt, like sort of just swoop up. It didn't look like it fit. So my goal was to kind of concentrate back here and bring the curve up anyway. So my point, yes, there is a point. The point was is that the pitting down here at the heel really wasn't that much of a bother, because I was going to wind up honing through that amount of steel anyway for the most part. No big deal. It's just one of the concerns that pops up when you're working on these old blades. Now, you're watching videos, you go on shaving forums, and you hear things like, I corrected the geometry and stuff like that. And it gets confusing when you're new. You're coming in, you're thinking about buying an old blade and you want to work on it, and you hear, oh, I corrected the geometry. It's not, well, that's out of my league. And I've used that term, and just for the sake of clarity, the way I look at it, I'm not really correcting geometry. What I'm doing is I'm actually just creating geometry that I can work with. The existing geometry here was, in my opinion, not that great. If you can see, I've actually honed on this a bunch already. All right, I'm not close to done, but I've done a bunch, and I've honed to the point where I'm getting a pretty much a good. I'm tipping this in the light. You can't probably see what I'm. Okay, now you can. The light going across here will show you that I'm hitting evenly on the spine, and the same on the other side. So I'm good there, and I'm hitting evenly all the way across the bevel. Now, people ask, how do I know if I'm hitting evenly across the bevel? I have a loop, and I look at the edge, and the existing edge when I got it was trash. It was garbage. It looked like it was set in place with a bastard file. And after working on a 1K, I pull it up and I can see my striations, stem to stern, evenly. If you don't have a loop or something, you can hit it with a run of Sharpie ink. You just take a Sharpie and go down there and black out the whole thing. Then you go and hone, and where you see silver, steel, after honing, you know you're hitting the stone. And if you have any black, then you know you're not hitting. I tell people to do that all the time, although I almost never do it. The Sharpie test works, but I just use a loop to look. And as I progress with different stones, I look the same way with the 4X loop over there, and I check my striations, and I can see the 1K being taken down, taken away, and you know, as I keep going. Actually, this is a 1.5K. This is Shapton Pro. This is like my preferred bevel setter right now. I have a Chocera 1K, which I love the stone because I've had it forever, but I'm kind of really getting dialed into this, and actually I am dialed into it, and I'm just really feeling it. The Chocera is thicker and longer, so those are great things. It's a lot more expensive, but I already own them, so it doesn't matter to me, the money anyway. Just kind of liking this. Sometimes I think this is actually a little bit faster, and yeah, I know it's a 1.5K and the Chocera is a 1K, but if you look at the, particle size charts that are online, you see that they're very close. And for all intents and purposes, they can be used interchangeably. I've actually honed, I've swapped them out in the middle of honing, and yeah, everything is fine. So that's that about the stones. Anyway, so what I want to do with this segment of this video is, in the photos, you'll see that I cleaned up the problem. What I want to show here is kind of like what I was doing to clean up the problem. The reason I'm doing it this way is because if I showed you everything as I was doing it, you know, I stop, I go do other things, you know, the video would be like, you know, a week long, and that would be kind of annoying. All right. So basically, you know, I start off, I want to get a feel for like what's going on. Now you will read what people will tell you to not ever, you know, touch the blade while you're honing, and there is premise there because you don't want to put, you know, pressure on the spine and wear it. You want to keep, you know, the edge, the bevel down on the stone, and just let the spine come along for the ride. But right, to start off, to get the feel, to check the balance, and you can see like I'm rocking here, start off right, get a feel for the blade, right, feel for the geometry. See, it's drying out already over there. Boom, boom, boom. All right, so I want to work in over here. So I'm going to start off with a roll, right? See how the blade's up? I'll exaggerate it a little bit more. Toe is up, right? And I want to come in, you know, and I'm just doing a little bit of that. Now, from the other side, it's basically the same thing. Now, I don't know if you can really see from there. Be best if I had two cameras, but I'm not a good editor, so that would be a pain for me to do in a post. But anyway, so what I'm doing here with this finger that doesn't belong on the spine is I'm steering and I'm using it for a pivot. You want to make sure you come into the heel, and in my case, I want to go past the actual, what do you call this thing over here, the stabilizer. I want to come past that, all right? And the reason for that, I'll explain. All right. Let me just explain for a sec. The blade here, okay, this portion was trashed, and the angles and the bevel and everything was like nuts, okay? It was no good. I honed up, and can you see it? You can see it in the close-ups right here. You can just catch it in the light. I honed up onto this section of the blade, stabilizer. I hope I got the term right. So that I can ensure the correct taper into the bevel through this portion from the heel into the actual cutting edge. All right. Now, it doesn't look great. It looks ugly. And if I was worried about looks, what I would do is I would do what I'm doing right now, right? And then I would do some sanding to correct. And then I would come back and then I would start honing stabilizer off, just coming like right to that point, like right there, right? Because that's your cutting edge. That's what you really want to work with, you know? So I'm just establishing, you know, this transition point. Because this here is a taper, right? This is wedge shaped here. You want to be able to, what you want to do is you want the material to become thin enough so it transitions to the bevel and the cutting edge smoothly, all right? Because that's how you're going to get the edge you're looking for, all right? Now here you'll see my hand on the blade again, which is, you know, technically a no-no. The pressure is really, really light. And what I'm doing is steering. And the reason I'm steering is because I'm on the die. I'm doing bevel work in the back of the house, which is not where I normally do it. I normally work up by the sink. So I just want to use my other hand for a little bit of comfort and security so I know that I'm getting, you know, the hit on the bevel that I want. And I'm not going to make a mistake and jack up my repair work that I've done so far. Now, I've done a bunch of honing, but I'm nowhere near having this bevel where I want. Right? The work that I have yet to do is probably equal to what most people would consider like normal work for setting a bevel. At this point, I just have like a repair, you know. I have a stage set so I can continue and be successful. And I'm not going to wind up with a problem down the road. Now, for me, one of the things that I'm prone to doing is like I'll overcorrect a little bit and then hone back into it. And the reason for that is if you undercorrect, you never, ever get where you want to go. So, for example, if I didn't make this taper thin enough, at some point down the road, I was going to be screwed. It's the way it is, you know? You can't do, like, any major work on, like, a 5K. So if you get to that point and all of a sudden, like, your blade is, like, tipping up because it's really too fat over here, and it's possible that you wouldn't notice. It can happen because a lot of this stuff is kind of subtle, you know? Swarf will still be doing an undercut, and then all of a sudden you're like, what the hell is going on? Now, for feedback, all right, right now I'm in a good place with my feedback on this blade from like here forward. In fact, if I just went ahead and continued my progression and then I was done, this blade would shave great from here to here because this is essentially set. The problem is back here. I don't have it yet. I can feel it, okay, on the stone, all right? I especially with the roll, when I'm rolling, right? When I have this up and I'm coming through here, I can feel the vibration under the blade. Well, it's actually in the blade. On the stone, you know, and it's nothing like the rest of the blade. It's not smooth, you know, and I want it to be smooth. So I'm just going to keep working at it, and I'm going to focus on that with my rolling stroke. And what's going to happen is, at some point, I'm going to hit that smooth. And because I told you I like to come up, you'll see me coming up onto the stone with that. I want to make sure that that transition point stays where I want it. So every now and then, I roll it up on the stone. You know, and actually, right now, as I'm talking to you, the feedback is smoothing out. Now, another thing. You know, I know a lot of you belong to forums and whatever. You know, so do I. I go to one. Just to belong to like, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 of them. one, I think I got kicked out of, the one that kicks everyone out. I maybe I'm not kicked out. I don't know. Just don't go back there anymore. One I go to like every couple of days, and one once a year. And another one, I left because I thought the moderator was a freaking idiot. So, my point. Now, you will see, let me see if I can tip and show you, right? You see I have a fair bit of spine wear, right? Here, here, got some going up there, right? You can see the bevel is not like this perfect line. It's not particularly skinny. You know, for one of these old blades, it's not particularly fat either. I can show you somewhere. It's just like, whoa, looks like a runway you could park a ladybug on. And up here again, you know, I have like some fatness up here on the spine and the wear, and some back here, and in the middle it thins out, right? There are people on the internet who frequent forums and other places that eschew spine wear. They're like, yeah, just recently I heard a story from a friend of mine, and he tells me this guy we both know sent him a razor, and the guy wanted a skinny bevel. And it was an old wedge, you know, and yeah, most of the time you're not going to really get a skinny bevel on an old wedge. I mean, you can, like, you know, but, and what I'm talking about is, you know, when you factor in bevel angle. But this guy wasn't factoring bevel angle. He was just looking for this visual, this aesthetic. He wanted to have, like, you know, big fat wedge, but he didn't want to have, you know, any real recognizable bevel. Apparently he has issues with, you know, wider bevels. And I remember posts from this guy going back years ago where he was like constantly crying about people honing and putting on spine wear. And I remember reading that stuff back then. I was like, what are you talking about? Because it's going to wear. If I took out a screwdriver of mine, you'd see it's wear. I ground it back. I have knives. You know, do I have anything out right here? No, actually, I don't. I was pretty good at putting everything away. You know, I have a Hego that's like one of my bench knives. And, you know, it takes a beating. Yeah, just don't know where the hell it is right now. I get it if you want it for a showpiece, but, you know, at that point, why even hone it, you know? So, you know, my friend told him, look, you know, I'll do it, but you're going to wind up with, like, you know, an obtuse angle for bevel angle, and it's not going to shave well. The guy gets it and says, oh, this isn't good, you know, it tugs. It's like, dude, like, where have you been in the course of this discussion? You know, can't really have it, you know, both ways. You know, if you have a wedge and you're going to put like a 22-degree bevel on it, oh, I don't know what that one mapped out to, but if you're going to do 22, 24, it happens, all right? It's going to shave like crap. At least that's my experience, you know? It's going to shave like crap for me. I don't know if it's going to, maybe people with like peach fuzz for beards. I don't have peach fuzz, okay? I had like miserable whiskers that like hurt edges. And on top of that, I don't prep, so I'm kind of screwed. I don't prep at all. I need an edge to be totally on point. You know, I don't like prepping. I don't like sitting around pampering my face and going through all that crap. It's just too much freaking time in the bathroom. It's like, oh, you know, I read guys that get hot towel machines and fucking hot lather this and scuttles and, wow, one guy had like a coffee maker in there to boil water to make lather. And I'm like, I live in Brooklyn in an apartment, man. I can't be doing that shit. I don't have the room. And it's really not what I'm about. I'd rather kill the edge quick and rehone it. I just want to go in and shave. Anyway, so you got this like fat bevel, this obtuse bevel. It's not going to shave, right? So getting back to where I was in the beginning when I started this angle. All right, I have this wear here, and there are people out there that eschew this, and they put it out. They broadcast it like it's, you know, truth. It's pure truth. You know, it's absolute, you know. And a lot of it is what I call the Pied Piper complex, where, you know, these gurus and these poobahs, they gotta have everybody like hang on their every word, and everyone's gotta do everything the way they want it. And like, that's ridiculous. It's shaving, bro. There are as many different ways to shave as there is to do anything else in this world. Yeah, you remember before when I told you that I was good from here forward? I was wrong. I have something going on up at the toe here that's not where I want it. I can tell with the undercut. If you've been watching, you might have seen some a little lack of undercut up there. And I don't know what's going on. Take a look at it. Could just be me, could be whatever. So anyway, going back to where I started, the geometry of the blade, you know, the stuff that people tell you you're correcting, you know, for me, it's like, I'm just, you know, establishing geometry I can work with. Things are what they are. If you're between, like, let's say 16 to 19 degrees on your bevel angle, you're probably in a good place. Chances are, if you have an angle that's less than that or more than that, chances are, no hard fast rules, do not quote me and say Keith said blah blah blah. No, listen to everything I'm saying, then quote me. All right, chances are, if you're outside of that zone, you're going to experience, you know, an issue here or there, or often, maybe all the time, I don't know. But you know, if it's too narrow, you could run into a situation where the steel fails because it's not going to hold that edge. And if it's too fat, you stand a chance of running into a razor that doesn't, you know, shave well. It's doggy, you know. And people with easy, you know, shaving needs, they may be okay with that. There are people out there, they only do one pass with the grain, then they go, and they're good with that, you know. And so for them, they don't need anything like, you know, like disgustingly sharp, you know. They're just good with like whatever, so it might work for them. Talking about for me, if I have a big blade like this, no way do I want this thing even close to 19 degrees. Okay? That's just been my experience, you know? And people, you know, I get challenged. It's like, oh, well, if you're in a blind test and, you know... And it's always these new jacks, like they just showed up, like, you know, in the last 18 months, and like they've declared themselves, you know, experts because, you know, they've honed a gold dollar and they bought a Norton 4K. You know, and I read that stuff and I laugh, and it's like, you know, how I shave has nothing to do with who I am. And, you know, if I tell you something like, you know, I need my edge to be where I need it to be, then just take it at face value. You know, if you want to, like, come up with all this, like, dick measuring bullshit, you know, oh, a blind taste test, would you be able to tell the difference between a razor and a... You know, I've spent the last whatever number of years I've been doing this, basically doing that, okay? You know, I've honed more wedges than I could count. I've taken pieces of steel, these Sheffields, up and down. Well, once you take steel off, it ain't going back on. But I've gone through all of the, let's try it at 17 degrees. Let's try it at 16. Let's try it at 15. Oh, we got complete fail at 14. Yeah, that's what I do at night, you know. I try stuff out like that. And I've done it multiple times, and I've gotten to a good place with it, you know. Sorry if I didn't videotape everything for you, but... And I keep telling people, you know, this is what I do, you know. If your tests yield different results, I'm okay with that. I'm just talking about, like, what I'm doing. You know, everything is subject to interpretation, you know. But, like, challenging me with stupid blindfold tests on what edge is honed to what degree on and what rock, I mean, you just sound like a moron. Yeah, okay, I got my toe back, so I'm, like, kind of happy about that. It's not completely back. I'm going to have to work on this a while. I'm not going to show you the entire bevel set. I'm hoping that you're picking up on some of what I'm doing while I'm rambling here about online stupidity. If I do nothing for anybody, if like this video reaches one person and he picks up one piece of information and the amount of time I spent making it, and trust me, there's a lot of time goes into making each one of these videos, then that time investment was worth it. Yeah, my toe's coming along, but it's not where I want it. Can you see the swarf? Can you see how it's like? Oh, actually, that one went okay. Yeah, it's just not rolling up the way I want it to. In case you're wondering how much pressure I'm putting down here, and good pressure, I don't know. You'll notice that I don't hone on scales to check like how much pressure. I'll be honest with you, I kind of like move my pressure around. Yeah, that's good. Yeah, I still have some non-smooth like kind of feedback going on up in this area. I can feel it. It's making me unhappy. So what's going to happen? I'm going to keep honing on this blade until I get that feeling I want from stem to stern, from toe to heel. I don't give a rat's ass how much spine wear I wind up with. And I don't care what the poobahs of the internet have to say about the spine wear on my blade. When I'm done, geometry will be good. The edge will be nice. I'll be able to shave without having to do 400 hours of prep first. You know, who the fuck wants to start prepping their face on Tuesday for a shave on Wednesday? I just don't get it. You know? And I'm guessing maybe if I spent like an hour like hot toweling and massaging oil into my skin or whatever else, that I could probably shave with less keen edges than I do. But yeah, it's just not my style, man. Besides, it's a lot more fun for me to shave with a blade that just like annihilates everything in its path. See me like coming up here? What can happen is if you're not hitting all the way through into the toe of your blade, you wind up with right here, right at the very tip, you wind up with the metal being fatter right at the shinogi. And what happens? You just never get that tip nailed down. So, again, and you'll find a lot of honing guys fucking tell you that this is wrong. Fuck it. It works for me. Okay. I come in. I'm going to come up a little bit, a little tiny bit, and not on every pass, just a little bit to like make sure I got that grind down. What happens? I wind up with a little bit of a extra wear up there under a loop. You can see the bevel do this like little, you know, right off the edge, but your actual cutting bevel, that's going to be fine. All right. Well, it should be fine. You have to check. You have to make sure that, you know, you hone it to the edge. I shave with the very, very toe. I also shave with the very, very end of the heel. Areas under my nose, I will use the heel extensively. Because I'm like right here and the heel is like right there, ultimately, there's more control to be had. If you're trying to control the toe from here, and we do, okay, but there's more room for error because of this distance, you know? So if I'm in a tedious area under my nose, I'm going to be inclined to be trying to do it with a part of the blade that's closer to my hand. You know, that's just for me. Okay, so now I'm getting that nice feeling up in here. Not quite as smooth as the rest of the blade, but I'm on my way. And I'm in a good position. Again, I'm steering here. I'm just trying to use as much of the blade as possible. The stone. If I'm not on camera, I'm pretty much doing it like this all the time. You know, but when I'm doing a video, I'm not looking straight into the camera. I'm looking at behind the camera. There's a mirror that I'm using as a monitor. The camera in this case is my phone. I know, which is crazy because I have two, three DSLRs here that they all do video, and they do a damn good job of it. I just use the phone all the time. Anyway, so staying in here, I'm focused. I'm talked up toward, you know, the edge. I have pressured down, but I'm making sure that I'm driving forward to the edge. All right. As I'm coming up to the toe, you see I'm doing a little bit of a roll, right? Because that's the grind of this blade is a little whacked. All right. So that helps me keep it consistent. The bevel, that is. Also, a guide like this one, I want to check undercut because I can go really, really slow. Now, I'm still short on my undercut on my forward pass. It's not coming up as smoothly as I like. It's undercut and then there's undercut. You know, I tend to run the blade to a point where I get what I call violent undercut. Now remember, if I go, boom, you know, the undercut is going to be one thing. If I go really, really slow, the undercut is going to be something else. So you have to be consistent in your approach to reading your undercut, okay? If you do it a bazillion times, literally a bazillion, you get a feel for it. If you're consistent throughout that entire bazillion honings, you'll learn, like, what your undercut looks like at what speed and pressure and how dense your swarf is, because particulate in the water is going to change things too. All right, so there's that. I'm probably going to keep working on this a little bit more, a lot bit more actually, because I'm a stickler for bevel, okay? I like, you know, all of that speed honing crap and all of that hack method bullshit and everything else that's out there that like allows you to put a a bevel on a edge and allows you to get, you know, some kind of cut on something. That's not my thing, okay? I don't do that. All right, I hone to max. I hone to max. I want to go into the bathroom tomorrow. I want to just literally take my soap, lather my face. I might rinse it off. Rinse my face first, but I just want the lather on there, lather it up, face lather, bing, bang, boom, boom, done. And I want to take this blade and I want to mow through everything that's growing out of my cheeks and chin and whatever, neck. No hesitation. I want zippity-doo-dah, like right through, like grease lightning. All right. None of that like, oh, well, you know, I have to like, no. I just want to whoosh, just like you saw in that video. All right. That to me is shaving. All right. That's what I want, right? Other people want different things. That's fine, you know. But I tell you, like cutting corners, it ain't going to get me there. Anyway, stay tuned for the next segment. All right, so here we are back for finishing touches on this wade. All right, so let me move my penguins out of the way. Put them over here on their little penguin island. A little less lat. Just hanging out. Okay, so basically, you know, I got the bevel set on this baby. And you know, when of course a honing, you know, off camera after the last segment, I sat down and checked it out with a loop and reviewed my geometry here. And everything seems to be really nice. There's a little bit of wear here, but, you know, as I said earlier, it's like not a big problem. But one thing I did want to point out is that up here, I forgot to mention this before, you know, right up in here, I'm going to try and tip it so you can see it, but I have a photo of it, a close-up. I don't know if you can catch it. All right. I brought the spine wear up past stabilizer shoulder over here. Over here. And again, it's like the work I did down here, right? I wanted the transition to come down to creating this nice geometry. I felt the need to start a little bit further past. So visually, aesthetically, it's not great. If I was doing a full restoration, you know, you would do all this work and then you would come back and you would buff and you would clean it up and then you would go back and hone and you would never see this because you'd be polishing all of this down too and it would all look the same. So, you know, I did that. I have that mark on both sides. And, you know, by honing up onto that, which is like technically by some, you know, unspoken textbook that's out there, you wouldn't want to do that. But this blade has been honed over the, you know, decades. You know, I'm not sure how old this puppy is, but, you know, late 1800s, early 1900s. So that's like a really long time, right? And the course of that time, it's been abused. So what happens is people hone, and then little by slowly, you wind up with like proper hone wear, like maybe over here somewhere, but over here, it's just too fat, and people just keep missing. And, you know, that's how you wind up with like crazy toes and bizarro heels and all types of crazy wear. And, you know, right now, this is looking really good to me, even though I have this like little chevron that pops up over into the shoulder area, but you know, whatever. Like I said, it's not a showcase. It's not a showpiece. It's going to be a daily driver type of thing. And anyway, so you know, I honed it on my Shapton Pro 1.5K, right? And I honed it on the 5K for a little bit. This right here is a Tsushima Black Nagura. It's a mid-range stone. It's not anything other than a mid-range stone. These are quarried underwater. Now, the quarry's been closed since the 80s, maybe late 70s. I got way too much slurry for what I want to do here. So, there we go. Got a nicer mud now. This is a different type of stone. It's not like your traditional shale that our Awasedo are made of. And it's not like Makawa Nagura, which is, I believe, volcanic, but I'm not entirely sure. This is particulate from the ocean that settled down. And somebody, I translated an email, somebody explained to me, and what it came up was that this is kind of... possible. I'm not 100% sure, but the person was telling me that this is his description was a parallel of what meerschaum is, but I don't know. You know, a very wise man once said, it's all well and good to know all this stuff, you know, about every stone, every layer and all this, but it doesn't help you hone any better. And if you spend a lot of time worrying about that stuff, then you might actually hurt your honing. And I'm inclined to agree with that, you know. It's like the expert-itis on the shaving forums. You know, everybody's got to, like, know everything. Anyway, that goes hand-in-hand with the Pied Piper complex. So anyway, these stones were really popular back, I don't know, 50s, 60s, something like that, with woodworkers here in the States. They call them ocean blue. Ocean because they were mined out of the ocean. Blue, I'm not really sure. Because predominantly they're gray. Now there's two different types of Tsushima. There's ocean, which is this, and this is basically like the coveted stone. And then there's mountain, which is, I'm told, it's been explained to me rather. It's a lower quality stone. It's less consistent. It's generally harder, but the hardness, is just one quality. They're not as consistent, and you know, they're usable on tools, or they're for tools that you don't need a super critical edge. So again, it was explained that you would be okay using it for like a work knife, like a Higo Nokami, but you probably wouldn't want it on like your best chisels, or you know, so on and so forth. So anyway, so here what I'm doing is, you know, I'm just working my mid-range. I could really stretch this out and really stand on my head and finish on this stone. And I would wind up with an edge I could shave with, but it's not the kind of edge I want to shave with. And like, I don't consider it a finisher. Most people don't. In fact, I don't know anyone who does. I know there's some buzz on the internet that, yeah, there's a guy made a video or whatever. I don't even know what that stone was. It was yellow. Must have been one of the rare Tsushima yellow Nagura stones. I don't know. You know, I don't know what goes on eBay. I hear all kinds of stories. I was just on the shaving forum that I go to all the time, and there was a thread on it. And I just stepped in to, like, you know, share, like, you know, the proper name of the stone. And there was, like, this, like, tension. And, you know, that's why I social media, like, based on dialogue, like that forum type thing. It's just, like, why am I here, man? You know, what, you know, I was just trying to, like, share a little clarity, and then all of a sudden it's like, you know, crazy. You know, it's like, wah, you know, who the hell needs that crap, you know? Anyway, I've had a ton, literally a ton of these stones. I don't know, 40, 50 of them, and they're all pretty much the same, you know? It's a very nice stone work with for mid-range for me. I like the feedback. It's nice. It's smooth. The cut is consistent. The haze on the bevel is like killer deep and lush. And, you know, it's an aesthetic you don't need to get into, really, if you're honing a razor. But I really like the way it looks. Another thing I really like about it is, like, if I honed on synths, right, which I have here and I do quite often, I find it best to try and remove the fingerprint that synths leave on the steel. Now, if you look at on the high magnification, and we all talk, you know, you remove the scratches from the last stone. You never really do. You just do a good job. With using this stone on top of, like, you know, for example, like a 3K or even a 5K Shapton Pro, you can really, really eradicate, like, I don't know, 95% of the previous work. You have to, like, really get into it. I've already done a bunch on the stone. I'm just picking it up in the middle of this piece because I haven't shown a TSB in a really long time. And I know there's some chatter on the internet, like, right now. So I figured I'd bring it out. I have a million options for this. You know, I have this guy right here that just came in. This is, like, one of the crazier J-Nats I've ever had. It is a Sinashi Suita Renge. It's, this side is so, like, lush and creamy, and it's such a fast cutter. It's nuts. And the other side is also either Tsunashi or Tome. I don't know if this is, like, a transition layer between the two. I have to, like, actually send an email and with specific questions to get a rundown on this one, but excuse me, this is actually one of the more interesting, unique J-Nats I've ever had, you know, completely different types. Anyway, so I've already worked with that. I could have done what I needed to do on that stone, but instead I decided to come here and to show off this one a little bit, and clean this off for a sec. All right. Just want to show the sides of these stones. You know, they come out of the quarry, you know, raw stone, and then they're sealed. And they're sealed because this is a very porous stone. Even with the sealing, generally speaking, you know, if you're dealing with an authentic Tsushima Black Nagura, even with the sealing, it probably at some point in its history is going to crack and give way on you. It's just the way it is, you know, and you save the pieces and you use them as Nagura, then you pick up another piece. Guys who really get into it, they use a washi, very, very thin washi paper to build up all the way around to add strength to the stone. And because I get mine sealed most of the time, I don't do that. I have the washi. It's a very special washi. It's, you can't just use regular washi. It won't work. It's too thick. You need, like, super, 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 super thin washi tissue, actually, is what it is. It is a name for it. I forget. Anyway, So if you look at this, you see you got like a gray blue. Maybe that's why it was called ocean blue. Maybe the term ocean black was too scary for people back in the 60s when these stones started floating over here. Mid-range stone, not a finisher. You can stand on your head with a ninja suit and get an edge that you can eke out a shave with, but I would not call this a finishing stone. It is specifically, you know, I'm talking about the real deal. People brought up an eBay stone. I don't know what goes on eBay. There's just like all kinds of crazy shit. There's people over there getting stones from, you know, hardware stores. They're not finishing quality stones. They're just whatever. They're selling them cheap. It's like the Wild West, you know. And then people over here, you know, they buy them and they're like, oh, this is great. Well, okay. I've been doing this a long time. And I have honed a lot on J&S. And I'm telling you, if you're not honing on a finishing stone, you're jerking yourself off. You know, tell me all you want how great it is. It either is or is not. And most of those stones, those Copa that are selling for like, yeah, like $40, you know. There was a retailer selling them. The name was Yunsho Honyama. Okay, it had a stamp on it. They were selling for like $50-$60. You know, a bunch of people tried to pretend they were great. I've handled actually a couple of them. And, you know, they're like decent knife stones. They are really in that pre-finisher class at best, you know. This is mid-range straight, not what I would call a pre-finisher. Anyway, so that's that with this. I don't want to keep flogging a dead horse there. Right? I'm probably already going to get hate mail from that one. Yeah, people get butthurt really easy. Anyway, so now, you know what we have here, right? Don't my mid-range on that. You know, I got it to a nice place. You know, I could go through a full Nagura progression, but I've actually done that segment of the honing. You know, where the hell is my tonal? And I really don't want to explore an extended honing session here. I have a reason for that, because I know I'm going to be rehoning this like 3 or 4 times, because I have a boatload of stones to check out. Anyway, this is one of the stones that will be on Etsy. Getting a good read for it. It's very hard. Very, very, very hard. You can hear it. It's got that sound, you know. This is a killer, killer, killer piece of Namito Nakayama Kita. Mix and match here on this Nakayama Asahi. This has that, like, that ugly Asahi, I like to call it, you know. It's like brooding. It's a dark, brooding, mottled green, stormy weather type of whatever. It's just, you know. Oh, very proletariat in all regards. It's nothing posh here, with the exception of this is one hell of a finishing stone, which is all we really need to deal with. No stamps, no Maruka, no Maruichi. Yeah, that Maruichi stuff. I have a couple of authentics Maruichis from back in the day. And when I say that, I mean they were stamped back in the day as opposed to being stamped in recent times. Very nice stones. There was a story at one time that Kato and Hatanaka and the quarries changing hands, and you know, and the person who was sharing that story, well, I don't know, let's just say there was some credibility issues there, and I don't want to get into any drama, internet personality drama, it's all bullshit, it's like waste of energy. But the point of me bringing it up is that, you know, that story just after time never really panned out. And after talking with, you know, some people, over the last few years, actually, recent stuff, generally speaking, the story comes back to me, and these are from people who know, these are people who deal, these are people who collect, these are people who, like, you know, are emotionally invested in working with these stones. And, you know, they have families who, you know, had miners and quarry workers over the generations. And, you know, it's just, you know, it's more than just a passing phase to them. It's not about honing a razor. It's like, you know, it's cultural, you know. Anyway, the story is from them that those Maruichis were not necessarily Nakayama. And that right there, pretty much, if it's true, blows the entire story that we all bought into long ago right out of the water. You know, and like when I got here, you know, I was like listening to what, you know, people were saying, and a handful of people selling stuff, and people on eBay, and people in the shaving forums, you know, talking about J-Nats, you know, what they were calling things like 60K J-Nats. And I kept reading that stuff, and none of it ever sounded right to me. And the more I read, the more I realized that people really didn't know what the fuck they were talking about. And that includes the people who were, like, selling stuff. Not all of them, just like a handful of them. A couple in particular, just completely full of shit. And if you go into the archives of, like, the knife forums from 2007, 2009, you can pull up those threads where it was just like, you know, the names are still around, man. They're still here. They're still with us, those people. And you could see, like, what was going on. And, you know, everybody was trying to, like, jockey for position to be the man with the plan. You know, everyone wanted to be Stan the Man. And just drama, man, just heavy drama. And people just, some people just making up the most bizarre shit. Anyway. Yeah, my point. I don't even know if I have a point. I'm just talking. You know, anyway, so you had all that stuff going on back then, and there was all that, the stories, you know, we bought into it. And, you know, there were guys, there one guy talking about how he can tell a stone at 100 yards by looking at it. And, you know, it just, you know, seriously, there's a guy who's maybe not 100 yards, maybe he said like 10 feet, but, you know, it's like, you know, I grew up going to quarries here, you know, there are holes in the ground where stones come out, you know, that just because the hole in the ground is in Japan, like, it's still a hole in the ground that rocks come out of. You know, I can tell you that, you know, the best you're going to be doing there is guessing. You know, there might be some telltale, like, patterns and stuff that, you know, over the centuries, maybe one hill was known to produce or whatever, but, you know, mostly what you do visually, what you can isolate is you can isolate like an area, you know, especially like, you know, I'll talk about firsthand stuff I know about, like tourmaline or better than that, turquoise. You know, and if you see a particular type of matrix and a particular shade of the stone and greens and blues and different types of matrix, you might be able to get a region. You might be able to pick up on that, you know. Opals, fire opals, you know, out of Australia, stuff like that. You know, they look like nothing that comes out of the ground here in the U.S. You know, but as far as, like, you know, the actual house address, please, man. You know, well, one guy got caught, like, jerking off a customer, and, you know, he leaned heavily on that story as his justification for making his decisions, and, you know, whatever. Look, it's like business, you know, and it's, you know, I don't fault anybody for trying to make a buck, but I just, you know, over the years, I just listened to so much bullshit in this JNAT trade, it just kind of pissed me off. To be honest, I got pissed off really early, so I just jumped in head first, real fast, and basically begged people to help me. And because I have a background in stones, and because I have an understanding and an aesthetic and a love for geology, and I can be conversant about, topics like lithification and what have you. Couple of people like, oh yeah, okay, so like you're serious, and they explain a little bit, and I'm still a noob, and when you want to compare it to like what people whose families have been quarrying these stones for 5, 10, 15 generations, but I got a lot of clarity. I got the clarity I needed, That's really what I wanted, I had no idea I would ever like be so blessed as to be able to rent, I guess is what I do, some stones. The number of stones that I've been able to experience, and that just keeps on going, and wonderful stuff. Jane has a great stones. I love conicals, I love eshes, I love all types of natural stones, but these babies are really something super special to me. Yeah, I'm trying to pick up a little bit of extra feel on the toe here. Yeah, my toe is good. I actually need a full basic rolling stroke here. I'm sorry I'm going so fast. I'm sure it's a little bit difficult to see what's going on because I'm doing it very subtly with one hand, but basically I'm doing a full roll, and I'm coming onto the stone here with the toe just up, like almost not at all up actually, and then I'm finishing with just the toe down and the rest of the blade up. And that is so I can hit evenly all the way across. Now it's funny, when I started honing, I figured out that I had to do that. I figured it out on my own, actually, because there was no other way for me to get an even hit across the blade. It was just, to me, it was obvious, I didn't know it had a name. I had no idea, And then someone told me, and I was like, oh yeah, I've been doing that. And they didn't believe me because, I don't know, people think like they got the market on this shit corner or something. I don't know. But I was like, no, really, I've been doing that. Just didn't know it was called that. I mean, there really is no other way to do it. The only other way to do it would be to like grind the stone so it matches the curve of the blade. Yeah, so that's not happening. All right. So I'm sorry about the glare. I've been trying to like, really work on all of this. Which light is that? Let me kill that one. No, it's not that one. No, it's not that one either. Where's it coming from? Oh, I bet you I know where that is. Yeah, hold on. Look at that. Could have had it gone the entire time. I've mentioned it a few times, like my monitor, so I can make sure I'm on camera and stuff. It's a shaving mirror that has these legs, and I got it propped up over there. It works. So yeah, I slurried again. I'm in a good place. My edge is nice. I can tell the edge is really, really nice. All right. You'll notice that I always work with a tomo nigiri. Man, I'm sorry. Hold on. It's been incredibly dry and humid back to back here for a couple of weeks. Anyway, so yeah, I always use a tomo. I do not use diamond neguras. I just don't get with the practice. I think for me, it's a waste of time. I've done a lot of testing back and forth. And while I do believe that a lot of people have tested back and forth and can't see a difference between honing traditionally and using a diamond Nagura, I also know that I actually have shown myself that traditional methods have yielded better results for me. And, you know, I can assume that, you know, like, well, Iwasaki's camp, like everybody, you know, under Iwasaki in Japan, they don't use diamond Naguras, you know, they use Toma. They don't even use them in the lap, you know. So, you know, I'm not saying I follow their lead. I'm just making a point. And like, if like using a diamond Nagura was better, then I'm pretty sure those guys would be doing that. I know, Pooh Bahs, they got all kinds of stuff to say. That's fine, you know, like if your edge is working for you, man, then like that's groovy, man. That's cool, you know. If you want to make slurry with like, I don't know, chunks of broken red brick, fine. As long as it works, you know, if it works for you, then it works for you. You know, I can't explain what works for somebody else. You know, I can only explain things that I know work for me. kind of funny like that. Yeah, I've never been part of the regurgitation crowd. Oh, what's that? Those are the people who float around the internet. They go one place, they read about something, they go someplace else and start talking about it like, you know, it's their idea or they know all about it. And, I don't know, it just kind of annoys me. It's not like sharing information is what it is, but when, and you know what I'm talking about, so you know, don't think I'm just picking on people errantly, because I'm not. There's definitely these people who are like, oh hey, you know what I heard? You didn't hear anything. You read it over on SRP, man. Please stop. You know. Yeah, so besides the diamond Nagura thing, you'll also notice that 98% of the time I finish on slurry, and you won't really find me diluting too much. There's reasons for that. I'll explain that in another video. You know. I put water down to keep the slurry wet, but I actually usually don't dilute. I work with a lot of slurry while I start off with a lot of slurry, so I can be assured of hitting the edge consistently and being able to get not only a consistent edge-to-edge cut, but a consistent, I guess, depth of cut. By having enough abrasive on tap, you know. Occasionally I will finish on water. It depends on the stone. It's usually not my thing. Now remember, you know, it's just my thing. You know, I have spent like my time learning to hone. Learning how to create the sharpest, keenest, smoothest edges I can create. I didn't just come into this and hone this way and then that's that. I've tried it on water. I've tried it, done the diamond Nagura thing. I still have my DMT, the credit card things. No, pieces of crap they are. You just continually shed diamonds. The fucking nickel substrate comes off and, ugh, what a waste. I have a small piece of a Toma that I use as a diamond Nagura to test, and it's a comparison thing. It's not like I find that the information I get from making slurry with that is in and of itself telling or whatever, because it's not. It's just like another layer. You know, you got to go through a lot of steps. Like this stone, right? It's going to be on Etsy in like, I don't know, a month or two. I'm going to hone on this thing, like, no shit, like 30 times. And, yeah, I'm going to know it backwards and forwards. You know, I already have like a dozen honing, full honings on it, full progressions. the feeling here is a cross between like a hard, I'm talking about the feedback on the stone, cross between like a granite and the melting chocolate bar thing that I get. So I have that like sort of hesitation feeling, but I definitely have that. It's like the, you almost feel like the blade is going to skate, but it's not. Okay. There's just enough friction in that melting chocolate bar to make sure everything goes Gucci. Yeah, with this blade, because of the crazy geometry, I've been doing some change ups on my strokes. The pressure here is exceedingly light. I was this guy that popped in to leave a comment on my video where I was showing lapping an Apache. And he was telling me that the way I had the plate was no good, that I was bending the plate. And, you know, I love it when people, like, assume they know exactly what's going on. You can't tell by looking at the video, is my point. You can't tell how much pressure I have. You can't tell how much pressure I was using on that thing. he's talking about, like, movement in the substrate in, you know, units of angstroms or, you know, parts of angstroms, you know, that's not really going to affect anything. And that type of concern here too, for finishing, people get like really wrapped up in it. That's my point. Yeah. You just use light pressure, you know, you want to work at being able to use the lightest pressure possible while still achieving some kind of result. You know, you put water down, it's like a, what do you call it? Lubricant, you know? So if, you know, you flow too light, you're not gonna be doing much of anything, you know? We say less than the weight of the blade. Some people get their shit in a bunch over that, whatever, I think they need to grow up. Yeah. So anyway, yeah, the guy with the, you're bending the substrate on the Atoma thing. Yeah, I had to kick him off because he became rude. I don't care if people like, you know, want to like have ideas and like, you know, they want to say they don't think what I'm doing is right. But, you know, I'm going to step to the plate. So you better be prepared. And I don't come unarmed. So like I said, be prepared. And like, if you turn nasty and you start acting like, you know, whatever, street and ghetto or circus animal, I'm going to boot your ass out of my channel because I don't have time for that crap. The way I see it, it's like if you're willing to like call me names, you'll do the same to somebody else in the channel. And, you know, I'm not trying to be an enforcer, but shaving forums are full of that crap. Reddit is full of that crap. Just don't need it, man. You're shaving, right? You're a scientist, that's great. Doesn't mean you're going to shave any better than me at the end of the day. So, like, put your PhD in, on check and be a little humble. Actually, I think those highly educated, and that's in quotes and sarcastic, I think those guys have more trouble with honing than, you know, a lot of other types. And, you know, I say types, I'm just talking like, you know, in general. I talk with a lot of guys, you know, I talk with knife makers, I talk with whatever, and, you know, guys that work with their hands and stuff. You know, yeah, they come in, they might get confused, but they pick it up after a while. It's all the book smart gets in the way sometimes, I guess, I don't know. And that's not a rule, it's just an observation that I've experienced. Certainly there's going to be a whatever, I don't know, a pizza maker who has difficulty honing. Not trying to make a stereotype, I'm just saying. All right, this is done. All right, I have In your glassy experience, I'm not sensing any increase in the edge. I'm not feeling any more advancing. I know that from this feeling on this stone with this type of blade that I'm done. I'm going to strop and then I'm going to shave. And I'm going to rehone it, I think, Sunday right now. I think I'm going to be redoing it on Tuesday. You know, I have another stone I want to check out. I got some on the Gura. I found this puppy right here. Found this guy. Been laying around. I'm going to take him out for a spin. And, yeah, I have a bunch of Macau and Agoura that I want to finalize the 3 and 4 piece sets. So I have work to do. Anyway, so like that's it. You know, that's, I'm sorry it wasn't like terribly exciting, but hopefully I shared a couple of things that made sense. And, you know, if you have any questions, leave them down below. Have any comments, please do the same. You know, if you haven't already, please like, please subscribe, please share the video if you think it's worth it. You know, other than that, you know, keep on honing, you know, hone till it hurts, then keep on honing, man. No matter what, though, always have fun. So take care. See you next time.